Okay. All right, so let me just start out by saying thanks for being at the meeting last week. I feel like we had a good conversation about our finances, like the groundwork for the next year. So I'm just grateful for this community, and I'm glad we had a productive, not too long meeting that also included pizza. So that's for you, Heather, the pizza. Okay. No, that was a serious downfall of pre-meeting advertising. Because it wasn't until like that day that we're like, for sure there's going to be pizza. So. That's true. That's true. I feel like we did have a core of commitment on Sunday because pizza was not promised. All right, so if you have questions, then let me know. All right, well, let's continue or enter into a spirit of prayer. I'm going to sing the prayer, so if you know the song, go ahead and pray with me. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I want to be a living sanctuary for you. All right, so that was a long Bible reading, right? Thank you for sticking with it. Thank you, Nell, for reading the part. And as I've mentioned before, this year we're using something called the Narrative Lectionary, which is a set of readings that go through the whole Bible over like the school year. And so it's kind of following the whole narrative arc of it. So that's one part of what makes it the Narrative Lectionary. But the other part that makes it the Narrative Lectionary is that it's telling stories. And sometimes the stories are, when we read the story, we read like the whole story. So even though this is a long story, I think it's kind of a fun one. I thought it was funny. So there's kind of like this farce element to it, right? That Jesus heals a guy, right? It's fairly straightforward. He heals a guy. I mean, it's amazing, but it's like this thing that happens, right? And we kind of see him do that a lot. But then somehow the healing happens, and then it upsets everybody all around the blind man. They can't get into their heads that what happened is what actually happened. So the neighbors are like, who's that guy? Didn't he used to be blind? Is that really him? And then he's just standing there like, hi, it's me. I'm standing here. I can hear you, you know. And so then they take him to the authorities who are like, well, there's no way this man could be healed because he did it on the Sabbath. Like, it's impossible, therefore. That means Jesus would have had to have done it on the Sabbath, which is a sin, so he's a sinner, so he couldn't have done it. And the man is like, well, I'm just telling you what happened, and I'm standing right here, like, I can see now. You can't tell me that I can't. So they don't believe him, so they ask his parents, because they were there, right? Except that they weren't. They weren't there. I don't know why they bring his parents in. And they're a little edgy, too. So they bring the blind guy back, and he gives them an interpretation they don't like, and then they kick him out of the synagogue. And finally, after he's kicked out, he meets Jesus face to face. So it's sort of interesting. Jesus is, like, not in the... Jesus, like... is in the beginning and the ending of the story, but there's all this stuff in the middle that he's not in. And so I just like the idea of how everybody gets, like, ruffled up and whirled into this upset. There's all this confusion, suspicion over something that's really beautiful and amazing and wonderful. And then in the middle of it all is this man who was born blind, and he just keeps telling the same story over and over again. You know, his story doesn't change, except that it does change, because he's telling the same facts. There aren't too many facts to tell, but as each group challenges him and asks him to explain himself and to elaborate, and then they continue to fail to hear his story, his story keeps getting deeper into who Jesus could be. Right, it changes and gets stronger. So first, Jesus is just a man, right? But then after the questioning, he says he's a prophet. And then after that, after they go get his parents who kind of cop out, then they go back to him, the man who's born blind, gives a really interesting and passionate speech that's maybe a little snarky on Jesus' behalf, arguing that Jesus must be from God. And finally, when he meets Jesus, he's ready to find out about him and to worship him. So what I find so interesting in the Gospel of John, as we've been reading it, is the way that Jesus treats everybody differently. And maybe that shouldn't come as a surprise, since God knows us all so well, knows all our uniqueness, has created each of us to be our own person, to bring our own gifts into the kingdom. But there you go. If what you were expecting was one-size-fits-all approach to ministry, Jesus is not doing that. He meets a curious and cautious scribe and twists him into knots with these strange metaphors. He meets a woman at a well and tells her own life story back to her. And then here in this story, he meets a blind man, he cures his blindness, and then sends him off with no other commentary. Just go and wash your eyes out. Now, for some of us, if we have an experience that's powerful, but it's kind of hard to describe, an encounter with God, or even something that happens between us and another person, if we can't get some confirmation from the people around us, it can be very easy to let go of the memory of the experience or the emotions of it. Or if we don't let go of it, then we want to hide it and try to avoid telling the story, or to hold on to the emotions for ourselves, rather than having to challenge the people around us with this thing that has happened to us. But for the man who was blind and now he can see, that's impossible. The change in his life is too big and it's too public for him to be able to hide or deny or avoid the confrontation. So he begins to see that the people around him are missing out on an important piece of reality when they can't handle the reality of his healing. He begins to kind of see the flaws in the system, so to speak, that the wisdom and the interpretation of the scribes can't take into account his lived experience, right? That they're supposed to be these wise people, but this thing changed and they can't explain it. Their paradigm doesn't have room for something that he knows is true. So because he can't avoid the conversation or pretend away this huge change in his life, he meets it head on. And in the process, he comes to believe that Jesus is from God. And all of this without Jesus saying a single word of explanation or introduction to him. And I think the story of this man who was born blind and then comes to be able to see is so long and so detailed because it's in some ways the story of the people who were writing John's gospel too, the community that is producing this gospel. We started out, they say, not able to see, and then Jesus opened our eyes. And we didn't know how he did it or who he really was, but we knew that before we were blind, that we were born blind. But now we can see, and that is the truth of our lives. And in telling that truth to people who didn't have room for it, we were questioned and not believed. Our families distanced themselves from us, and the authorities kicked us out of the community. But we know the change that happened to us, and we believe that Jesus is from God, and that he is the Son of God. To quote Martin Luther, "Here I stand, I can do no other. God help me." So what's our good news here? I know for me personally, I go back and forth about what I know and what I believe about Jesus as the Son of God. Some days it feels like, sure, God became a person, okay, cool. He was also still creator of the universe, awesome, makes sense. And then other days it's like, I don't know what this gospel is trying to do. Jesus has some good teachings I can get on board with, love God and love each other, that's cool. But I just want to be sure that we hear from the community that's writing the Gospel of John and writing it to each other and to us. This was their experience of Jesus. While he was in the world, he was the light of the world. He shed a new light on everything. Before they were blind, but when he came, they could see. Their lives were turned upside down. And because of that, he could open up the whole world into something new. And they came to trust him. They came to believe him as something more, something deeper. He is, they say, the Son of God. For us, for you, for now, for always. Here we stand. We can do no other. God help us. So today we'll be taking communion. We'll be eating bread and drinking grape juice as a way to remember Jesus and his extraordinary, inexplicable life among us. For the community of John, Jesus lit up the world in a new way. And in his use of the symbols of bread and wine, Jesus opens our eyes to our connection with him and with each other and with the earth. May we meet Jesus in the meal, and may he heal us. And in healing us, may he open our eyes and make us new. Here we stand. God help us. Amen. So let's have some time for silence and reflection. And then our reflection question is the next one, if you want to. Thank you. Has there been a time for you when you saw things in a whole new light? So let's have some silence and reflection, and then we'll talk about that question. Oh, I don't even have...